A very good evening, everyone. Welcome to Admiral Markets. We're going to take a look at this webinar, How to Trade Divergence. So I think that's going to be a great topic, and glad that you can join. Glad that everyone is here. And let's take a look at, of course, this PowerPoint explaining, first of all, the risk disclaimer. And that explains that trading for exchange in global financial markets is considered high risk and may not be suitable for all investors. Please seek the advice of an independent financial advisor for more information on that. And this video and live webinar and webinar is for educational purposes only. So thank you for your attention on that one. Once again, welcome to this special webinar, of course, hosted by Admiral Markets. And my name is Chris, and Tarantula is here with me as well, and also Michal, in fact. And just wanted to emphasize the great spreads, for example, liquidity, market depth, great prizes here at Admiral Markets as well. So before we dive actually into this agenda, let me say hi to Michal, a manager from Admiral Markets.
Good afternoon or good evening. Good afternoon, Chris and Tarantula. Thank you very much for passing the word to me. I will use it with great pleasure. Thank you very much for tuning in for our webinar tonight, guys. We have a great topic for you a little bit later, but right now, let's speak about something that is really important to every single one of us before we even download our first platform. I wanted to speak to you about one very important thing. We have a very good audience for this webinar today, and the number of both live sessions and webinars has been on the rise lately. All of you who decided to participate in this webinar can always Google my name, find me on LinkedIn. I'm very happy that some people actually are doing this, and my content base is growing every day. You can always reach me on my email and my Skype. I'll give you a little bit of time to copy all the information down. Once the webinar is finished, if you have any questions, I'll be very happy to answer them. And the number of those live sessions and webinars has been on the rise lately, and it's very, very nice to see that. Not only do we have participants that are currently trading with Admiral Markets, as a lot of you are, we also have people who are yet to make the first trade, and of course, we also have traders who are currently with other brokers. I extend my warmest welcome to all of you. I hope you enjoy the first part of the webinar and learn new things, and it's going to be a lot better when the webinar actually continues. But that brings me to the point I wanted to make. Why do we choose one broker over the other? What sets apart one broker from the rest? There are a number of factors you should consider before you make a decision. And of course, you should consider the platform, the spread, deposit methods, amount of instruments, variety of account types, and so on and so forth. You choose the factors most important to you, and you make a decision. But of course, none of those factors matter if the key factor is missing. I'm pretty sure all you've guessed it, the key factor is, of course, trust. No matter how great the conditions are, it all means nothing, absolutely nothing, if you do not trust the broker. In fact, none of those factors even exist if you do not trust the broker who advertised them. This is the amount of trust you should have to your broker. Look at those people. They trust each other completely. And the same should be on the financial markets. At least this is my belief. You're entrusting the broker with your funds. And you should be 100% sure that this broker is trustworthy and is going to be acting in your best interest. Because investment is a very difficult subject. And the trust is one of the most important things. If a broker with a dodgy reputation advertised a one pip maximum spread, would you believe it? I don't think so. No. Most likely the spreads are higher. And even if they were that low, you would not probably be able to withdraw your profits if you made them. So you see that trust is the main factor, the most important criteria. Trust, of course, has been a critical issue for the past few years, especially in the financial sector. And if you would never buy a product from eBay if the seller had a less than 100% positive feedback, why would you settle for less when it comes to a broker? After all, you entrust your broker with substantial funds, and the level of trust should also be substantial. So how do you choose a trustworthy broker? For, as most of you have probably noticed, there is not a single place on the internet that will present you with 100% accurate data. And more often than not, broker ratings really depend on the amount of money said broker is willing to pay to the website. So here are a few things you should look at. First off, the most important thing, in the financial world, there's always someone watching. In this case, I'm talking about the regulators. In order to receive your license, you must comply with strict regulations. And the more regulators you allow to watch you closely, more secure you are. Admiral Markets, for example, is licensed in European Union by FCA and has obtained a passport from MiFID. Admiral Markets has recently received an FCA license in UK and has been licensed by Australian Financial Services. But being licensed, it is very, very important, but Admiral Markets is not the only broker that is highly regulated. We are not the only ones that are authorized on many continents, and this is why we decided to go further. In the Facebook era, we at Admiral Markets decided to go this extra mile, especially just for you. Rather than sharing a transaction, we want to establish a personal relationship with our clients. Our policy is to provide a personal account manager to each of our customers. If you have a real account with us, if you have a demo account, if you participate in the forums board, there is a person in our company that can help you in your own language. Not a member of a support team, no. An actual person that is responsible for your account from the time you registered in the company to the time you decided to withdraw your huge profits. So, in essence, this is our actual size. We have more than 30 offices in more than 30 countries worldwide, and this is the level of customer support we are striving to provide to our customers. We're a huge organization with a customer support of a local butcher or a hairdresser, personal and friendly. I would like to say that I'm a great example. I work with customers in UK and Ireland, and if you are watching this webinar from one of those countries, chances are me and you have already spoken. At the start of the presentation, I have shared my email and phone with you. Here's also my Skype and LinkedIn. All of our customer relationship managers would be happy to do the same. We at Admiral Markets believe that in the modern era, trust is the main virtual currency. We conduct our business in an open and friendly manner. And before we get your business, we are ready to establish a relationship with you. So once you feel we have a one to trust, register an account with us, only to find out that our spreads on major fears is as low as 1 pip. We accept bank payments, wire payments, card payments, and Skrill. We give you a variety of accounts to choose from, standard, professional, all sorts of managed accounts, and a special CFD account as well. Register an account today, and meet your personal account manager in just a few hours. To him, you'll always be a number one, most important client. Just like all my clients are the most important clients to me. If you have any questions, please write me an email, Skype me, or call me. If you want to add me on LinkedIn, I will gladly accept your invitation. I hope you had a great time, and I wish you a pleasant week. See you at the next live training session or the next webinar. Thank you very much. I will now be passing the microphone to Chris and Tarantula. Thank you very much, guys.
Thank you so much, Michal. Always great stuff from Michal and very interesting. Today we're going to talk about divergence and why that is so important, because it is really a key aspect, and also, in fact, I think for all traders, I wouldn't know which way the trader wouldn't look at it, but really we use it a lot in the trading room as well. One of the key elements in deciphering and classifying what's going on with the market structure in a forex currency pair. We're going to take a look at different types of divergences and how we can trade it. All right. So, do you yourself use divergence? What indicator do you use? And if not, why not? So we got some questions right to the left for the public. First of all, let's see. Who is actively using it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's see who is using divergence. It's very important. But before we start, I want to wish you all good day, and I want to wish you all a good week, upcoming week. It will be very volatile. So Now let's see about, let's concentrate on divergence. Who is using it, who have been using it, and why do you use it?
Now maybe my introduction didn't invite the responses to answer this, because I was saying who wouldn't use it, but please be honest, if you don't use it, that's okay. That's why you're here, in fact, and that's always the first step.
Okay, we have
show up.
A guy, he's saying he uses stochastics. Okay, stochastic indicator is also good, but for divergence, we usually use MACD or awesome oscillator. So stochastic is not so reliable in regards to divergence. MACD and awesome oscillator are better. But okay, if you don't know what to ask us, or if you don't know which indicator you use, we will explain how divergence is used. This webinar is being recorded, so also after this session you will be able to look at it again. So okay, I use divergence in CCI. Yes, CCI is also can be used in divergence. There are some few good systems that use the CCI. So it's okay. It's okay. It's more or less, it's not the same as MACD, but it's also very good. There is very good usage with CCI concerning divergence, also on lower time frames. But we will concentrate now on MACD and on divergence paths. I will show you what are types of divergence. I will show you what exaggerated divergence is, because most of you probably don't know what exaggerated divergence is. So you will see that. So CCI and stochastic, anyone else, if there is no one else using divergence, we will continue with our session.
I think everyone is still a bit shy on this.
Yeah, a bit of shy.
Yeah. That's okay. Everyone will warm up when we start, I guess.
Yep. So what is divergence? Divergence is an indicator and price action being in disagreement. It's perfectly well explained, because when indicator and price action are in disagreement, we have divergence. That means that the indicator is heading up and the oscillator oscillator as an indicator is going up and price action is going down, so they're in disagreement. They're making divergence. Divergence means they are diverging from each other, so that is why it's called divergence. They are diverging from each other, and they're not in agreement. They don't agree. So it's also where the price and set of relevant indicators such as MACD and the price action are moving in opposite direction. It can be an indication of a reversal or a continuation. It's usually used as reversal. Divergence is usually used as reversal, but it also can be used as continuation signal. Continuation signal can be seen on any time frame also as a reversal, but to be honest, guys, always use it, and it's always better to use it on higher time frames, as always. 1 hour, 4 hour, it's perfectly good to use it on 1 hour time frame for intraday trading. So it's really the easiest way possible to spot an early trend reversal or retracement, so you can be early in the trade. So with using divergence, you can take an earliest entry possible. And there are many types of divergence, but you will use only one. If you are trend trader or if you want to counter trend, then you will use another type of divergence. So we will see what those divergences are.
Yeah, usually indeed with the currency, basically it all boils down to having a higher high with price but the oscillator not confirming that would be divergence. In fact, if it does confirm, of course, then that's a sustainable trend, right? That's what it all boils down to. If we get a higher high, let me put a schematic here. If we get a higher high in price and it's followed by the oscillator, then we are good to go. That is, in fact, what we want. It's a sustainable move, a sustainable higher highs and higher lows, indicating a sustainable trend. But the problem is that if the currency is doing this and the indicator of your choice is doing this, well, obviously there is a divergence between them. They're not confirming each other. That's why it's called divergence. Price is in an uptrend, but the power, the momentum, or the oscillator is not confirming that, thereby creating a warning for us as traders that maybe something is fishy here, maybe something's not adding up right, and we should investigate. And depending on the time frames, we'll dive into later, but basically, of course, at the very bottom, you see the higher time frames are more reliable in these kind of, or more, have more impact on the moves of price. You could expect more movement based on a higher time frame divergence. If you have divergence on the week chart, you could maybe expect a bigger retracement or in pips, in terms of pips, or a bigger reversal. Also, if you have multiple divergences on one time frame, for example, if you have two divergences on four-hour time frames, that too is a more powerful signal than only a signal divergence, right? And divergence on multiple time frames, of course, will give more confirmation as well. For example, day and week and 4 hour, right? That's a lot of divergence, just to give an example. So those are things that add to the importance of divergence when you do have divergence. But even one divergence on one time frame is something already that could be enough to give a bit of retracement. How much? That is always the question. We never know exactly. But that is a bit of a warning signal there. And you have type A and type B is just the difference between if you have double top or a higher high. Okay. Let's move on to an example. And basically here you see price is making a lower high, or let me use red circles in fact, a lower low, excuse me. And the awesome oscillator, which I'm using here, is giving a lower high. This is the euro dollar, and it's a 1 minute chart. Okay, so it works in all time frames. Of course, logically, the higher, the better, definitely. And here we're seeing some bearish divergence, excuse me. This is a 1 hour chart. That's a bit more useful. And you can see the multiple divergences going on this 1 hour chart. Price is making higher highs, but we're getting lower highs here at the divergence at the bottom there. Here I just wanted to explain with this text that the correction can have two different outcomes. You can go sideways in time with that, or you can get a more active retracement in terms of pips. So the main benefits, right, Tarantula, basically it kind of gives an indication of future movements instead of a lagging indicator like many are, in fact.
Yeah, so let's see. Main benefits are basically that it's divergence is not lagging, it's leading information. That means
exactly
that you have leading information in front of you. You will have information which has already been accounted, but at the very moment you're looking at it. Also, you will see that is a method for predicting future price movements, and it analyzes a possible reversal. So there are also two ways, Chris, as I explained before, two ways for using trend rates and counter trend rates, right?
Yeah.
Do you have anything to add so I can continue?
On this slide? Well,
yeah, on this slide.
No, absolutely. It's just indeed best for the trending environment with the trend or reversals. Range bounds, indeed.
Yeah, basically.
Have basically more use for stochastics, indeed.
Yeah, that is more useful than stochastics. I agree with you. And also, it's basically what you are using to take an early entry. Let's say that, divergence is very, very nasty. It can be nasty. The main thing is, and you should remember this, that divergence does not have to have immediate effect on the price. That means that we won't take an immediate entry when we spot divergence. Many traders make a mistake When they spot divergence, they make an immediate entry, and then what? They're usually stuck in the trade. They're usually stuck in the trade because divergence is not traded like that. There are very few rules that we have to respect when trading divergence. We will show you later what are the rules for trading divergence, but the main thing is to remember that you should not take an immediate action after you spot the divergence. Divergence needs some time to develop. So that is very, very important. Also, let's say that why divergence is important. It's an earliest indication of reversal, and it can be an earliest indication of continuation also. So those are two, that is the main benefit, and it also has a good benefit because it's a good sign to exit the position. So if you are, for example, short and you spot, for example, a normal bullish divergence, a regular bullish divergence, you will exit your position. You will not continue with keeping your position, because usually that is a sign to exit, especially if you are very close to support or resistance if you want to go short or to stop a long trade. Also, it's a good sign to scale into position. If you are a swing trader, if you hold your trades, for example, for more than a day or for maybe more than a week, or maybe you are a longer-term trader, divergence will give you a good position to scale into position. I have seen many traders use that type of trading. Especially, divergence can also be used with RSI indicator. I used it 2.5 years ago. I don't use it now, but it has some potential. It can be very, very good for spotting, especially for adding, scaling into a position. So, that why is that important? Again, it means that you are usually buying near the bottom or selling near the top. So we are not talking now about a breakout trades. When you're doing breakout trades, you know, you're buying into resistance and you're selling into support. So when you're buying near the bottom, you go with a trend, or maybe you're going a counter trend, but in both ways, whatever you do, one thing is certain: it will give you a low. It will give you good risk to reward ratio. At least the risk is low, so that makes the risk potential very small related to your potential reward. So that is a good thing concerning divergence. The bad thing is only it's very important to know again about those exits and entries with divergence. If you don't do a good entry, well, it will probably spike your stop. So that is why divergence is also important. You need to know when to enter, not to enter blindly. And Chris has already explained to you why is that the main thing and the main part of divergence. It's not the spotting divergence itself. It's the way how you will trade it. And we have a question, and that question is concerning it's earlier indication even compared to William percentage. Yes, because William percentage is not confirmed. It can be confirmed when that line crosses, if you know what William is, upper or downward or down or lower line. But divergence is a little bit with it's how can I say, it's more. It's more sure than it's Williams percentage. It's more reliable. That is the best word for that. More reliable than Williams percentage, because less traders use Williams percentage than they use MACD or ROSM oscillator divergence, and just because of that, it's just because of that. It's earlier indication even compared to Williams percentage. Yeah, it's an earlier indication. It's the most early indication you can ever have. That's for sure, guys.
What I think what you said was very good, Tarantula. In fact, what I would like to emphasize is what you said about divergence is just part of the whole market analysis and structure, and it's very important information, but indeed it's part of the part of the thing. We have to look at the structure, the behavior of the moves, impulsive correction, the tools you use, basically, whatever tools you use, those are still in play. This is just an addition to that analysis, basically. That's what I wanted to say. Very, very good point. And yeah, regarding the tools, we mentioned here a few already. My favorite, as you might know, is Awesome Escalator, and Tarantula uses the MACD. Both of them have the same outcome. It's just what you personally prefer. Take a look at both and take a look at which one like suits you the most, of which one you find many chance more easier to view or whatever. All right, that's something you can personally choose. Both are working fine. I use the AO because I think it's, for me, it's a bit easier to see where, when the it's just the bars, when they reach the zero line, it's easy for me to see that, and that's what I use also for deciding any wave counts, when to fib, which swing high, swing low to fib, although most of the time it is visual, also easy to identify, but also for divergence and convergence, which one, of course, we're talking about in this webinar. So we got all types of different divergences, in fact. We got the regular ones, so we got regular bullish and bearish, right? Those are the number one and three here on your screen, okay? But we also have hidden, in fact, bullish and bearish again. So there are four types, okay? That's what it boils down to. And the last one, Tarantula, right?
Yeah, the last one is, well, it's a pretty new for many traders. It's called reverse exaggerated divergence. It's a little bit of double top and double bottom divergence, and it's very, very new for some traders. But the thing is that we will usually deal either with the hidden or with the regular divergence. Regular divergence is a standard type of divergence where we should reverse the trade or close our entry, because it will go usually in opposite direction. Hidden divergence is divergence where we would presume that the trend will continue. The trend will probably continue when we're dealing with hidden divergence. And exaggerated divergence is again a reversal sign of divergence, but it's a little bit different than regular divergence. So we are basically dealing with three types and with three types of divergence and with five subtypes. So it's either regular bullish or bearish, or hidden bullish or bearish, or reverse bullish or bearish. So I will show you all of those types on practical example, and later how we can trade it. We have also a question: how is it related to fib with Awesome Oscillator? Chris will explain you just after I finish with my part of presentation, so he will explain you how it's related with Awesome Oscillator. Don't worry about it. So we can see that on practical examples. So here is what Chris wanted to say about regular divergence and hidden divergence. Chris, you have the word.
Yeah, basically, indeed, wanted just to mention that the regular divergence usually gives an idea that we have a retracement or a reversal. Now, which of those two depends also on the time frame, how many divergences we have, how is the structure of the market? Are we at a major resistance? Are we at a super big monthly trend line and weekly trend line, and that is, you know, the big 786 fib confluence? Well, then a reversal with that divergence could be quite likely. Or is it just a one-hour single divergence and it's well set in an uptrend on all the other time frames? Well, then probably retracement is more likely. So that's just to give an idea which of the two could play out. Hidden divergence is, in fact, more of a trend continuation, in fact. So while the regular is the opposite, you know, focused on the retracement or reversal, counter trend, I should say, the hidden divergence is with the trend continuation. And although you could have actually regular divergence actually within the uptrend as well on a smaller time frame, but that's something that would be more of a trend continuation. If you have, for example, 4-hour uptrend and you have divergence between the bottoms on the 1-hour chart to the downside, that's, you know, that's also actually would be a continuation sign. In any case, as we already talked about regular divergence here, I'll skip that. Hidden divergence, basically, what it boils down to is that if you have a higher low on price, all right, so let's put it in the schematic. You have price moving up, down, up, higher low, right? Higher low right there with the green circle. The oscillator, however, sorry, that's high, lower high, excuse me. Opposite, getting confused here, lower high. Oscillator, in fact, does the opposite. Oscillator is moving up, down, but does break the top. All right? So that's the difference there. The opposite would be true for this one here. Exactly the opposite of regular divergence. I hope that, is that clear to everyone? We can do a downside example where we have, lower high on price, but the oscillator makes a lower low. Higher low. That's this example. Is that clear? Yes, no, no, yes, maybe. So we're looking at price at a higher low, oscillator at a lower low, the bias is in fact bullish. Okay, good. That's great. Sorry about that, I got confused myself with the wrong letters. So regarding when we have divergence, that's at the bottom here. Proper divergence, in fact, is when the oscillator is back, the histogram, the bars are back to the zero line. And bad divergence is when the histogram has not returned to the zero line. That, too, is useful information as well. Maybe I have an example. Then no, there's no example. Okay, it doesn't matter. We'll continue. Maybe there's a. We'll show you later on in a chart.
Yeah, but here is also a simple explanation with the regular bullish divergence. Let's start with regular bullish divergence. As I already said, regular divergence is the most frequent. It's usually considered a sign of trend reversal. So if the price is making lower lows, but the oscillator is making higher lows, this is considered to be regular bullish divergence. We either exit our short position or we prepare ourselves for taking a counter trend trade and entering a bullish mode, bullish trade. We don't need just a series of lower lows. We just need one low to be lower than the previous low. So there are many traders who were talking about it. We need to have a lower a series of lower lows in order for divergence to be stronger. That is not true. The truth is that we just need one low, because oscillator usually MACD, let's say, is lagging oscillator it uses lagging histograms. And because of that, we need only one low. We don't need series. Because with one low, we are sure that the trend has already started, right? So we just need that one simple low. Okay, and it can be found near the bottom. So regular bullish divergence is always found near the bottoms. So we use it at the very levels of the supports. Not resistance, we use it on support levels. This is regular bullish divergence. Price is making lower lows, as you can see it on the picture. It's one low only, and the indicator has made a higher low. So in that case, we are thinking about and we are charting our platform for possible entry point. Right? Just be patient. We will show you how to enter divergence. But prior to that, we need to introduce you to divergence so you will know clearly what to do. So this is price action of a regular bullish divergence, and indicator in this case I'm talking about MACD. It can be also awesome oscillator, so doesn't matter. It's making, or it made a higher low. So as with price action, we don't need a series of higher lows. We just need one higher low, and we just need one lower low. Concerning the price, it's lower low. Concerning the oscillator, it's higher low. Okay. No, it's okay. What is hidden divergence? Hidden divergence, as you already know, is usually considered a trend following type of divergence. It's prominently it's used in markets. Well, it's used in trending markets or with trading strategies that use higher time frames. We can also use it we can use it of course on 1 hour time frame or 4 hour time frame, but it's mostly it's used with swing trades. So we mostly use it with swing trades because we can add to our positions. If you know what we were talking about, we can add to our position, add to a winning position. So that is when we usually use hidden bullish divergence. Or we can use it to signal us that we continue with a trade. So we don't exit at the very support level. For example, let's say that we have a hidden bullish divergence and the price is nearing and it's very close to resistance. If we spot that the price is making hidden bullish divergence along with oscillator, we will not exit around that resistance. So we can let the price move on, right? We can let the price move on in the north side, of course. Hidden bullish divergence happens when price is making a high low, but the oscillator is showing a lower low. So price is high low, oscillator is lower low. Of course, as it is a trend continuation signal, and we call it hidden bullish divergence, it can be seen when the pair is in an uptrend. So we spot it when the pair is in uptrend, right? And hidden bullish divergence hints to the chart continuing to go up. That is most important. As I already told you, it hints to the chart that the price will go up, so we don't exit at the very resistance. We can let the price continue to go up. So that is hidden bullish divergence. And this is a sign of hidden bullish divergence. The price is making, as I say, we don't need series. We just need one lower low, and the oscillator is making a series or one higher high. So we want to spot a higher high on oscillator, and on the price we want to see a lower high. So that will be the sign of immediate hidden bullish divergence, guys. Okay, next thing is hidden bearish divergence. So what is hidden bearish divergence? It's opposite to bullish, of course. And it's usually a sign of a trend following type of divergence. In this case, we have trend following, we have a trend following bearish trend type. Okay, we are talking about bearish trend. So hidden bearish divergence is when price is making lower high, but the oscillator is making a higher high. This can usually be seen when the pair is in downtrend. So we don't usually exit our short position. We want to let the price go to the short side because it's a sign of continuation. And also with every hidden divergence, in this case bearish, it hints to the chart continuing to go down. So we want the chart to go down. We don't want to exit our position. We want to keep it, guys. So that is very important to know, very, very important. Also, we want to say that hidden bearish divergence is also the sign of a possible trend continuation, but only when the price is going lower. So we don't want to see the price going no way to the upside. So we just want to follow the pure price action. So that is hidden bearish divergence. Follow the price. It says follow me, come with me. So this is a good example. So market is making, or price is making a lower high, as we can see on this slide, or it made a lower high, and indicator has made a higher high. So this is hidden bearish divergence, guys. Okay, reverse divergence. What is reverse divergence? So it's called also exaggerated. It's a special type of divergence. Exaggerated bearish divergence can be usually found at the top of the larger move. Exaggerated bullish divergence can be found at the bottom of a larger move. Okay, bearish at the top, bullish at the bottom of a larger move. It's similar to regular divergence. The thing is that the difference between these two divergences is in exaggerated divergence, price creates double tops and bottoms for similar high and lows, but the oscillator will not make same double top and bottom. This will be more clear when we show you the example, so don't be impatient, just wait, we will see that on practical example. So we are talking about double tops and double bottoms, usually, we will see that. So this is example of exaggerated bearish divergence. This is bearish, we have double top, right? So it looks as it's double top. It doesn't matter if it's not perfect double top, but it's very, very similar to the double top. It's price. And indicator, you see, after the high, it made a much lower high. So the second high on the indicator must be substantially lower than the price high in comparison. So you see, we have a high on price, but the on oscillator it's much lower high. The high is not that big, it's much, much lower. It looks like the oscillator or price action are diverging, but the price action is pretty straight. The price line where you chart the divergence is pretty straight. It's very it's double topish, and the oscillator has a much lower high. It has a big slope to the downside comparing its previous high and its current high. Okay, I think that this will be more clear on our examples. And this is also exaggerated bullish. It's similar to a bearish divergence, but the thing is that a bullish divergence has double bottom. So the double bottom, when double bottom is created, we watch at oscillator, our indicator, if it makes much higher low comparing to previous low and high low to a price low, that means that we are having an exaggerated bullish divergence. So it will look like the price is wanting to make some sort of double of, well, let's say flat top ascending triangle or some sort of wedge pattern when you watch those two lines. So the second low on the indicator must be substantially higher than the price low in comparison. Yeah, you will see the charts. We will show you the charts, so don't worry about it. We will show you the charts.
And here's an example. I'm not sure if we have exaggerated, but there are a few convergences, and at the tops...
Later, yeah.
Yeah, later we'll see example. Good. Here we can see that the oscillator is confirming. We have higher high, and so does the oscillator. All right? So we got convergence with the tops, with the higher highs and higher lows. But then if we move on to the right side here, we have, for example, an oscillator. Look at this. The oscillator clearly making a lower low, but price doesn't make a lower low. Right? And in fact, then between these two bottoms, we have the opposite, where the oscillator is making a lower high, but price is making a lower low. So some hidden divergence there, bullish and regular. No, both are hidden. Let me see. This one is saying regular. This one is regular. Yes, I'm getting that is regular. And then we have regular bearish divergence here between the tops because we have an oscillator which is not following through and giving that higher high just like prices. All right, so that is the problem when the price doesn't get followed through. But one thing we have to show you and emphasize is that the top got broken around here. We have that thick green line. So everything above that already has that hint of divergence, but nothing gets an immediate effect. As you can see, price still continued for a few days. Actually, these are all daily candles. So look at how many daily candles still went up and up and up and up. You're talking easily about 2-3 weeks of price action before we got that rejection and the daily divergence played out, which was already visible, as I said, way, way, way earlier. So very important. The convergence, basically, what it boils down to is that there's a high probability or statistical probability, high likelihood of continuing with the trend. So it's a with the trend confirmation. The divergence is the opposite. It says that there's a likelihood of a correction coming, as we already said. Now that correction could be a retracement, a sideways retracement. Well, then maybe we'll have a continuation. Or the retracement could be very quick and impulsive and move a lot. Then maybe there's going to be a bigger correction or a bigger retracement reversal on our way. When we have multiple divergences on multiple time frames or on the same time frame, the likelihood of a reversal is increasing. So if we only have one divergence, then a retracement is more probable. But if we have multiple of those, then not a small retracement could happen, but maybe a bigger reversal or retracement could happen. And the hidden divergence is the same like the convergence continuation mode. All right. I already talked about this, but this just kind of emphasizes what you can expect from regular divergence from a single one. I emphasized here, not sure why, but in any case, it's always valid, in fact, by regular divergence that you can have, as I already said, a passive retracement or more of an active retracement. A passive retracement is when you have, for example, a strong move up in price, and price just bounces back and forth like this and makes a flag and a range like that. That's a passive retracement. Why? Because moving averages, for example, will be catching up with price while price is not going anywhere, in fact. A more active retracement is when price has the same structure, but then instead of going sideways, actively moves down towards those moving averages that are catching up with it and towards the Fib or whatever tool you use. We already talked about it, but just to emphasize it, be very careful with expectations regarding the lower time frames and how many pips they can move. And regarding the higher time frames, how long it takes before it actually plays out. So both we have to be careful, but for different reasons. The 1 hour chart, maybe because it just doesn't go anywhere, and we have divergence, but we just get a passive retracement. And the higher time frame, because it really could take longer than we think before it happens. All right, we talked about that too. Use other tools, right, as a confirmation. So there's a checklist here at the bottom. Look at your time frame. Do we have multiple divergences on that time frame? And check the other time frames as well. So what time frame is very important, because the higher the time frame, the more information. Then check the other time frames and check if there are multiple time frames, multiple divergences on that time frame as well. Now, I'm going to show you an example of the euro-yen, and I'm going to show you the weekly, daily, and four-hour chart. Way back in summer 2012, well, it's not that way back, a year ago, and basically what you see here is the weekly chart, and this euro-yen was in a downtrend. It fell very impulsively. It was making kind of a falling wedge on a weekly chart. And you can see right here, we had multiple divergences on the weekly chart, but it took long before it played out. Here we had divergence, here we had divergence, and all those up moves, although there were some retracements, there were only retracements. With the third multiple divergence on the weekly chart, we finally got the bigger impulsive move up, of course, as we know, under Euro Yen, to the upside, right? And the rest is history. The rest you probably know because that's all 2013 anyhow, right? So we was actively looking at that this year. So that is just an example of multiple divergences on the weekly chart. But what happened? The same period of time where I was showing you the third multiple divergence on the weekly chart, here we have the daily and the 4-hour. And here, too, we had bullish regular divergence on both time frames. So this is, I guess, a classical example of divergence on all time frames, especially on the higher time frames, that also gave cause to a massive, massive up move. And this was just the beginning, by the way, folks, because this move from 94 to 103 was just the very, very beginning. We moved up to 107 very fast, then all the way to 115, then all the way to 132. Let's see. This is a chart with two moving averages. That's the purple and the green line. And basically, you can see at the angle that we're in a trend, first of all. And we can see that the pullbacks are retraces. And what I mean with the zero line is this. Look at the oscillator at the bottom. And you see where I have the purplish circles. That's when the currency has moved back to the zero line. And what we mean with that is that we can compare the bottoms now, or the tops, with each other and consider them proper divergence. So that's something that still needed to be clarified maybe. If there's any divergence between in this area, right in here, between the purple lines, purple circles, that is bad divergence on this time frame. This is a 4-hour chart. That could be a proper divergence on the 1-hour chart, because then the oscillator would have returned to the zero line, but not on the 4-hour chart, which means that this is actually one swing high, one swing low on the 4-hour chart. And any divergence within this piece, in fact, is 1-hour divergence. All right? That is also then, in fact, the 4-hour fib that should be used with the swing high, swing low. And there will be many swing high, swing lows and fibs within this move that you can use on the 1-hour chart, of course. But in fact, don't worry regarding the fibs, because we'll have a webinar next week on fibs as well. That's just the same time, same place, 1 week from now. And we'll talk about fibs. So we'll take, you know, we'll look at that session. Let's see. The brown circles here, or dark red, are areas with divergence, proper divergence, okay? So you can see that although here, the first one we got, no, the first one is way up here, right? On the left, at the top, the very top, where we have the green circle. You can see we got a total reversal at that spot. With this divergence, we just got a passive retracement, more or less. With these divergences, we got, well, an active retracement, right? So we got an example of a reversal at the top, passive retracement, active retracement, and then the last example we got was a bigger reversal in a way. So here you can see the different things as well. Some other tools you can use, for example, are trend lines on the oscillators. It's not something I really do myself, but it makes sense. It's just not something I actively do, but it's definitely something that you'll come across in the theory, and it makes sense, I think. It's worth taking a look at. And it confirms also the trend line of price. When price moves through the trend line, take a look if that's something similar is happening maybe on the oscillator, for example. Something you can take a look at. So how to trade divergences? I think Tarantula is going to give you some feedback on that. One of the first things is the candle close.
So
right?
Here is the candle close. It's very important. So because candle close, it's always spotted divergence is always spotted and they can close. So we need to spot that close and we need to see if there is any sort of divergence. For that kind of trading, MACD divergence works excellent. It works excellent. So the thing is how we use it. It's very simple. We need to, I will show you also a chart of that. We need to draw a trend line and or to wait for break or MACD cross if no other contra divergence can be spotted. So when you spot a divergence, we need to draw a trend line or wait for the break or trend line or MACD cross. And we always use MACD 2 line. It's modern MACD. We don't use MACD which is by default installed on MetaTrader 4. We use MACD 2 line for that. I will show you that on our next example. So here is the thing. So you see there is a regular bullish divergence, right? We have two lines which mark the divergence. Those are marked in blue color, okay? And now after we spot the divergence, we make a trend line. So after I spot it, I draw that red trend line. Also, I want to see whether the trend line will cross first or eventually the MACD blue line will cross above MACD red line, right? So we want to see what comes first. Either it's the trend line or it's maybe that MACD blue line crosses the red line. I have marked also with a vertical gray line, I have marked the entry. So in this case, a trend line entry happened in the same time with MACD cross. Okay, so we need the confirmation of that divergence, because in the meantime, you see, there is probably, this was a late part of the day, and we don't do divergence in Asia session. We want to see either in a London or New York session, but in Asia session I will skip that. I don't do that because Asia session, it's only important to for daily highs and lows, and for there is no big trend in Asia, so I would suggest not using it on in Asia sessions. So the thing is, we need to wait for a setup. After we spot it, we need to wait for the entry. The entry may come after a few bars. I would like to see divergence happening after it has been spotted in the next three candles, if we are talking about 4-hour time frame. So it can be in next 12 hours, but for intraday trading it would be good if it happens in next 2 hours. It's the best if it happens in next 2 or eventually 3 hours for intraday trading. But due to low volatility of Asia session, we can say that we can make we need to be just a little bit patient. So if it happens in London session, we are good to go. But we need to make sure that in meantime there is no other divergence, right? So that there is no, for example, bearish divergence, because then our bullish divergence will become tradable, right? So what we do is we wait for the price to touch the support. In this example, we see that the price has indeed come very close to support, and then we want to see that reversing of that spot or very close to that spot. After it has reversed, we wait for trend line break or MACD cross. In this example, trend line broke at the same time as MACD has crossed, the blue line has crossed red line of MACD 2 line oscillator. Okay, next example is hidden bullish divergence. This is also a good example of hidden bullish divergence. As we can see, the price is in uptrend. We use hidden divergence in uptrends, right? So this is a part where we can make a new position or we can add to existing position. Again, in this example, we can see that trend line has been broken and retested at the same time as MACD blue line is crossed the red line. So that is a very good confirmation, and it's perfect because it happened two candles after it has been spotted. And remember, guys, this is 4-hour time frame, so two candles of 4 hours, great. Even it doesn't matter, on 1 hour two candles are perfect, in 4 hour time frame also two candles are perfect. So that is really the earliest entry we can have, because in this time we can see that the price has indeed break through this trend line, but it also retested at the time that when MACD blue line crossed the red line. So in the same time the price has broken and retested that trend line and retested the previous support, right? And you can see how it developed. Well, there was a candle, it stopped grabbing candle. Well, it grabbed some weak stops below, but eventually oof, it was a big up move, almost 400 pips. So that is the advantage and also the disadvantage of trading those 4 hour time frames, because your stops need to be really bigger than our standard time frames of choice, right? So in this case divergence would have worked, but well, the stop should be a little bit higher, should have been a little bit higher, right? But nevertheless, it is how divergence works and it is how we trade it, right? Let's see our next example. Regular bearish divergence. What is regular bearish divergence? Well, we need to see first the uptrend, then we need to see some consolidation at very resistance. In this example, we can see again the price, we can have two entries on this example. You see that the price has broken to a trend line and it has retested it. After that, MACD also showed the entry. Earlier entry was a trend line break, and one candle after it was a MACD, when MACD confirmed our entry. So even if you enter immediately after this trend line broke, you would have had a confirmation of MACD blue and red line crossing to the downwards in this vertical gray line. So that will be another confirmation that the trend is about to change. So again, this is how divergence is traded. So it's two simple ways: make a trend line either on 1 hour if you trade intraday or intraweek on 4 hour time frames, and then wait for the trend line to break or MACD to cross. You need to see MACD cross and that red, in this example, you need to see the red histogram forming in, right? After that has happened, you are sure to enter the market. Okay. Hidden bearish divergence again. And now this is a good example how trend line can be retested, but also how MACD entry can be better than the trend line. Because we can see that hidden bearish divergence has been established. This is a downtrend, but what happened is that the price has rallied a bit too far of this break of the trend line. You see the trend line has been broken, then we had some sort of a bullish little hammer, then shooting star. Usually after the shooting star we would suggest that has been a retest of this trend line, right? But what happened is stop grabbing. In this three-way pattern the price has grabbed some stops, but afterwards when blue line crossed red line, red histogram has been formed. And what happened is the price really went to the downside. really went some 200 pips to the downside. So if you ask me, I prefer make the entries. But again, it's up to you, because trend line can be a little bit, maybe a little bit earlier than MACD, but you know, MACD is a great trend capture tool. So when it grabs the trend, it holds it. So I prefer MACD entries. But again, you can do trend line or MACD entries. It's up to you. It doesn't matter. With trend line, you would probably get a little bit more earlier entry, but you need to place maybe a bit of a stop loss. But with MACD entry, stops can be a little bit lower, but you will get in a little bit later. You will get in a little bit later. Okay, next slide is reverse or exaggerated bullish divergence. Okay, you can see here in this example, again, we have a double bottom, right? The price has been falling and we have a double bottom. Also, oscillator has made a high low. Again, we make a trend line. I have made a trend line in this example, and also I have marked MACD cross. So basically, trend line has a one candle earlier entry than MACD, but both entries would have been good if applied. So in this example, again, earlier entry by the trend line, but MACD has confirmed the entry, so you can proceed with holding the position if you have made a trend line entry. But nevertheless, even if you enter with MACD two line entry, it also has been good. It was also perfect. But well, I can say that in this example, maybe they're basically that they happen in the same time. I cannot say that it's a bit of later, maybe one bar later, but basically again in the same time. Because again, we are talking, this is daily chart, and when you make an entry daily chart, you need to be prepared to have a big stop, right? If you trade intra-week or intra-month, well, you need to have a big stop for that. So the rules are a little bit different concerning stop loss, right, and target price. Usually those guys who trade daily hold their trades for a long time. So I don't do it, but this is just example of reverse exaggerated divergence. And we also have next example, if I remember correctly, that this is reverse exaggerated bearish divergence. Again, you know what patterns are. In this example, we have M pattern form. It's a bearish pattern, M. M pattern with double top, and again, we have a lower high on oscillator, right, on MACD, right? What happened is you can see the cross of the MACD to the downside, and in this example, we didn't make a trend line just because this is M pattern. M pattern, you know how to trade it, we already explained. So when you see a possible M pattern, we will see for either 2M to break, or we want to see MACD. In this example, MACD 2 line is crossed a little bit earlier than M has been formed. But also, if you want to trade M pattern, you would do it with a retest of this support, right? So doesn't matter what, again, exaggerated bearish divergence has spotted a trend change correctly. And we would have made earliest entry possible by placing MACD entry. I have a question. How to know where is the beginning of divergence? Okay, use for starters, because you don't have very experience, I presume, in spotting divergence by naked eye. You need to use a tool called indicator, right? So try to Google for it. There are some free indicators which support the divergence, and that sort of divergence will be spotted. But you need to be sure that the tool uses MACD 2 line. So you need to be sure that for these kind of examples, which I do and I use, you need to make sure the tool uses MACD 2 line, not RSI of or standard MACD. So MACD two line, guys, right? Okay. So that is how you can spot the divergence, the beginning of divergence. If you have anything to ask now, now is time to ask. If there are no questions, we can conclude our webinar, but surely if you have any questions, feel free to ask us, guys. Chris, do you have anything to add concerning those divergences and examples?
Nope, no, it looks good to me. We've got one question here. How to trade if we spot bearish in 4-hour and bullish in daily? Recently, I spotted this in New Zealand dollar and exited and market ran up. So we got bearish in 4-hour and bullish in daily.
Well, guys, daily is more stronger, right? It's stronger, right? Daily is stronger than bearish, but if you spot those contra divergence, you maybe it's a good time to wait for a long entry on retracement. Bearish in 4-hour will give you a retracement on daily time frame. Okay, so if you go with bearish, be sure to enter long when there is some substantial pullback to the downside. That is how I would do it. If you have a lower time frame, bearish divergence, and on higher time frame, a bullish divergence, you wait for the pullback because there will usually be a pullback to that lower time frame, right? But you may enter on lower time frame and then go in that direction which higher time frame shows you. Okay, do we have any other question?
Yeah, where we can see the webinar, in fact, I think. Can we see this webinar registered? Well, I think that we can mean is that if you go to admiralmarkets.com, click on education, go to webinars, and you'll see video archive here. If you click on that, you'll see the entire list of all of the webinars we've actually recorded and held here since beginning of this year, and you'll see all of them lined up, and this one will be added to that archive as well. So that you can see that again if you wanted to, just like any of these previous ones. And if you wanted to register for live ones, by any chance, if you don't know, it's right here at Live Webinars. And you'll see, for example, next week, Tarantula's topic, how to use divergences as well, in fact. And next week we have Fibonacci, for example, and some live sessions regarding trading as well.
Yes, and for new traders, I also show some kind of these examples how to use divergence. I will present also possibly an indicator to use it, but that is for new traders. But of course, you can attend to a webinar. You're all welcome, so don't worry about it. I will show that again. Also, which time frame can we use for day trading, for intraday use, 1 hour and 4 hour time frame for intraday trading. Okay.
Darshan is asking if there would be a way to take advantage of the 100 pip corrections in the dollar pairs. What do you think? I don't know.
Well, guys, it's hard to tell at the moment. Okay. Concerning cable, GBP-USD, my presumption is that eventually we can have an entry, but don't hold me for certain, but from this perspective, a good entry would be around anyway between 60.40 and 60.20 with stop loss around 59.90. Because I'm watching cable at the moment, because cable has had a substantial good retracement to the downside, and now it's around 60.35, 60.40, and anyway anywhere between 60.20 and 60.40, I would maybe now it's late for me to place an entry because I usually don't hold for trades overnight. I would place an entry maybe as close as to 59.90. So anywhere between 60.40 and 60.20, right? And maybe the target for that move would be, again, retest of the highs and possibly 62 for cable. For euro, I would say that we can have some good retracement towards 34.80, 34.60. At this moment, price has been trying to break, but to substantially break 35.15. So if it breaks substantially on 1 hour time frame, the candle closes below, few pips below 35.15, we can have a retracement to 34.75, 65. But tomorrow is a profit-taking day, and well, we may need to wait for tomorrow. We will see. But I surely hope for some retracement. I hope for some retracement because the price, from this perspective, looks like it might go to 36.20 and even to 37. Okay? But again, we need to wait for that kind of retracement. Historical buyers are found around 35.15, and as I said in my earlier analysis, 35.15 pullbacks could be buy into dips, could be bought into dips, but also 34.65, let's say, 70.65, around that. This retracement is not big on euro part. And let's say about Aussie, a few things. I would look maybe for an entry if it happens around 49. I would like to see 49 because 93.75 is good support. And previous week support is 93.91. So anywhere just above those two levels, I would look to buy into, right? So, but we need to wait again. Now the volatility will fade. We will see, but those are levels to watch for. Yes, Aussie is approaching 61.8. So you can see the reaction. You can watch for reaction close to that level, but Aussie is very, very close to that level. Yeah. But yet again, 1 hour is bearish, 4 hour we have bearish pattern. Daily is still in uptrend, so let's say that close to 94, we could possibly try to search for long entries. Yeah. Okay. Chris?
That's it, huh?
Yeah, that's it. I think that we are finishing with our webinar. Now we have many questions, but I think that we could maybe we need to talk with Admiral Market organizers, and we can maybe make special webinars about where we can give our possibly entries or maybe levels for traders. We maybe can do that once per week. We will see. It's also my and your view of the market, so let's see, maybe, because I always have many questions about where the price will turn, what would I suggest, where we can make an entry, what, you know, every yep. now and then, so, well, we will see. Now,
yeah,
there
definitely.
Are many questions about price action. How we could see signs of shorting from the tops? GBP had weekly resistance around 61.50. Shorting from the tops, either by using divergence, okay, either by using divergence or candlestick patterns around the tops. GBP had really a good resistance around 61.56, but you need also to know that cable reacts violently to the news, right? So today news came out for cable, but news were really it's worse. It came worse than expected, right? And it was a sign. It was a sign for substantial selling. But the move from 62.70, 62.50, oh sorry, 61.50 to 60.80 was done in, I think it was done in a minute. So there was no chance to trade, or it was very, very, very hard to trade because the move was very, very volatile. It happened in a minute, and it's the thing that usually happens with cable. Now watch the euro. It really has been bought of 35.15. You see how the price reacted to 35.15? Well, I'm not sure now. It's a bit late, but I'm not sure now that 35 will break. We need to see overnight reaction. But the substantial buying around those historical buyers around 35.15, guys. So now the price will maybe, it will make, I know it looks like it's making tweezers. Okay, if you don't have any questions concerning price action, which time frame do you use? 1 hour, 4 hour for intraday trading. Which time frame can we use for day trading? 1 hour and 4 hour. Thank you guys, have a nice evening, okay? Following yesterday, thank you. Following yesterday's upsurges, how could we have taken 100 pip corrections? How could? Okay guys, I didn't. I haven't taken any of the entries. It was very hard, very, very hard to trade this correction. This is not a correction. This was a violent reaction to FOMC tapering. So no tapering news has been released. So well, it was very dovish. Comments were very dovish for Ben Bernanke. So I'll stay away from these moves. Okay, stay away from it, because if there were any substantial signs of tapering, well, what would have happened is euro would fall like a rock. Okay, that was gamble. Yesterday was gambling, pure gambling, guys. Okay, do we have any other question?
Also, don't forget, Darshan, that in this case, if you do have divergence, but you don't have the candlestick patterns that you were looking for with that, we talked about it earlier in the day, right, about the weekly resistance, then what can you do? There's nothing wrong with missing one move, especially in such a strange environment as Tantala has been mentioning as well. So there will be plenty of days and trades not to come. That's also something that we can think about as well.
You always need, guys, trading is a mental job also. You need to watch higher time frames. I'll just give you a cue of this price action at the moment. Today is Thursday, right? Tomorrow is Friday. Traders need to be prepared for upcoming profit taking. Okay. And now this level, 35.15, historically, it has been good, resistance and support. It has been a good buying from this level, historically. So traders do not want to risk, do not want to risk placing short orders when daily trend is clearly in uptrend. So that is one of reasons why we say buy into dips, because we have uptrend. You can make profits from shorting the trend, right? Shorting into tops. But also you need to know when to buy, because if you position yourself now, or let's say now, hypothetically now, you would be able to grab more pips because the trend would probably continue to go higher. But the main thing is, and the main problem is, tomorrow is Friday. And we don't know whether they will close a short or long orders. I can presume that market maybe they will maybe close long orders in order to prepare for some bigger retracement, as I said, 34.65. But also you need to watch that from wider perspective. So buy into dips is currently the option for intra-week traders. Okay. Okay, guys. I'm glad to...
All right. That wraps it up.
We can wrap it up. Yeah, Chris. So, guys, feel free to come and feel free to hear from us and to attend our webinar, mine and Chris also. And let's talk again on Monday. And also, you will have a live webinar with Chris. So, feel free to sign up and we will talk. Maybe we will make a special webinars about market analysis. That's in our plans also, but we will see. Thank you for attending, and okay, many questions, but we don't have the time to answer it now. Let's talk about it later, guys. Okay.
Yeah.
Please save your questions for later. Bye-bye and take care.
Yes, we also wish you a great evening and weekend, and thanks for all the questions. Cheers.